We feel happy to invite you for this day one hands-on session on machine learning using Python. Now I invite Mr. Pradeep T. Rajan, sir, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE, to introduce our eminent chief guest and the speaker of the session too.
Good afternoon to one of our present here. It is my privilege to introduce our resource person, Dr. M. Caroline Viola Stella Mary, to our AICTE sponsored 6-day STTP, who is going to talk about machine learning using Python hands-on session. When we talk about her educational background, she received her BE degree in Electronics and Communication Engineering from the Government College of Engineering, Tirunelveli, in 1988. After that, she finished her master's degree from Anna University, Chennai, in 2009, and received her PhD degree from Karunia University, Coimbatore, in 2016. Later, she worked as lecturer in Karunia University from 1988 to 1989. She was with the Government College of Engineering, Tirunelveli, from 1992 to 1998. Also, she had an experience in industry as system programmer with Compute Thinking Computer Company, Alshark Kuwait, from 1998 to 2005. Currently, she has been working as a professor with the Department of Information Technology, Francis Xavier Engineering College, Tirunelveli, since 2006. She has published a book on mobile computing for polytechnic students. Her research interests include medical imaging, biomedical signal processing, and machine learning. She also published several papers in international journal and conferences. He has received fund for conducting a 14 days FDP from AICTE and also fund from DRDO for conducting a national level conference and fund for conducting a national seminar from ICMR. She is heading the ERP division of Francis Xavier Engineering College for the past 2 years. We feel so honored and lucky to have you as a speaker today, ma'am. So I now hand over the session to our speaker, Dr. M. Caroline Viola Stella Mary, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you for the introduction. A very good afternoon to one and all gathered here. Now to the machine learning session. Now we are going to learn machine learning using Python because today in today's world, Python has become a very powerful tool in artificial intelligence. So I will tell you how easy it is because when I did my PhD, I did all the programming in MATLAB. So my PhD work was on digital image processing and I did it on MATLAB. So when I came over a switch over to Python, now the Python tools, they are still more easier to implement and for simulation and everything. It is very easy when you do it with the Python. So today we are going to see how we are going to use the machine learning tools using Python. So before that, we will have a slight introduction of how we are going to see what is machine learning and what are the important concepts behind machine learning, and then we will go on to the hands-on session. Okay, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, your voice is audible.
Okay,
ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Visible?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
So today we are just going to see the basics of machine learning only. Machine learning is like an ocean. So there are so many things that has to be learned in machine learning. But today we are going to see machine learning to a slighter bit. That is, we are going to have a tinge of it. That is, we are going to have kickstart of machine learning in Python today. Okay, so what is machine learning? Why in today's world so many people are talking about this machine learning? Now, usually when programming started to come into practice, usually when we say write a program on or something like that, when we say, immediately we will tell when it is our students or anyone, we will be telling, identify what are all the inputs, identify what is your output, then what process we have to do on these inputs to get this particular output. This is what we used to do in programming. That is, First, we will determine what are all the inputs we are going to give into the program. And then we will determine what is the required output of the program. And after all this, we'll determine what is the process that we have to determine. This is the traditional programming practice that we have. But machine learning is something a little slightly different from the traditional programming. I'm going to say this is my input and this is my output, and what is the function I have to have? That I'm going to determine. What is the function? That is, I have x, I have f of x. What is this function f I have to do? That is, what is the programming logic I have to implement? That is the thing that you have to determine in the case of machine learning. So that is what it does. Machine learning is getting computers to program themselves. If programming is automation, then machine learning is automating the process of automation. That is, you are automating a process that is called as programming. Then that programming itself, if it is automated, then it is called as machine learning. Now, writing program, the software is a bottleneck. That is, for good developers, we have to write an optimized programming. That is, we have to let the data to do the work instead of the people. That is, we give the input, it gets processed, we get the output. We don't want people to process the data. So now in machine learning, here it is a weight in a programmable scale. That is, here we are going to give, in the next slide you will be seeing, machine learning, you are having the data and the output I am giving, I get a program. This is the program, this is the input, this is my output. Then I want to know what is the program that I have to execute. So this is what the difficult task is. So this is what the machine learning does. Traditional programming, we give the data and the program and we get the output. So this is a small basic of the machine learning. Now, there are some key elements in the machine learning. First is representation. How we are going to have the knowledge being represented. Now, machine learning is something artificial, related with artificial intelligence. So something related to knowledge. So how are we going to represent the knowledge? Whether we are going to have decision trees. What do you mean by decision trees? I'm going to take a decision. I say tall people, who are all tall? Oh, okay, above 158 centimeter is tall. So this is, I will categorize as tall. I take a decision. So these all come here. After that, I take a decision each time. Then I take a come to a conclusion of what will be my output. That is a decision tree. Now, set of rules. For this, I will be having some fuzzy. That is, fuzzy logic will have a set of rules. Then graphical models may be there. Neural networks that represents like our brain. That is, one neuron will trigger another neuron. So how this triggering of neuron works, one input I give to the brain, how it is coming as output. All those things are taken care of in the neural networks. And the support vector machines, how we are going to classify them. And these are all the things that we have to take in the case of representation. How our data is going to be, our knowledge is going to be represented. If then rules or some decisions or on triggering basis, how it is going to take care. That is the first thing we have to take care in the machine learning. Second one is evaluation. That is, we have a hypothesis. That is, we will have one hypothesis which will say, this is the accuracy. After I have this accuracy, so my program is okay. This can be accepted, an accepted rate, a prediction and recall, squared error, likelihood. You will evaluate your program. You have to say how far your program, how far your machine learning is good. For that, you have to have some hypothesis. So these are some examples of hypothesis: posterior probability, cast margin, entropy, KL, knowledge level divergence, and others. So all these things that we will be taking care in the evaluation scheme. Once the machine learning we are fixed, now that machine learning, whether it is fitting our data and the model, we'll be taking care and we'll be evaluating our hypothesis. Then optimization. Optimization is a very important tool, because if you don't have an optimized code or optimized output, you won't be having a very good search process or anything like that. So optimization has to be a very important one. And these are the three key elements that you have to take care. How it is going to be represented, how it is going to be evaluated, how it is going to be optimized. So these three things we'll be seeing in the KLM. Now, the next thing which we are going to see in the machine learning is types of learning. That is, learning is a very important thing in the case of machine learning artificial intelligence or neural networks or whatever it is, learning is an important one. The learning rate, how it is. Now, what is this learning? Now, let us consider the first time we have taken to cross a road. Now, our mom and dad would have taken us and they would have said, look to the left, look to the right, and then cross the door when there is no vehicle on both the sides. So we will be looking to the left and the right, and even if a vehicle is coming, if it is at a very long distance, then we cross the road, running across the road. Now we started learning. So this is how we cross the road. Little by little, as we grow up, our learning started growing, and then we don't need our mom and dad are there, or just see a very quick glance. And even if the vehicle is coming a little closer, we just dash through the road. Now the learning rate has increased here. So this is how our learning is. Same way, the program for our data, it has to learn. We will give an input and say, oh, this is the thing. This is how we have to cross the road. This is how it has to happen. If it is like this, this is the output. If it is like this, this is the output. Like that, we will be teaching it, and it will be learning at a particular rate. And depending upon the learning, we'll be having an output. Even the same thing is with driving a car or driving a motorbike. All this is learning. First time, you will be very, very difficult in the process of driving a car or a vehicle. Now, when you are very comfortable with it, we don't even have any difficulty in driving. Because the learning is high now, now we just go through the things. That is the things. So, one moment. So, this is the thing that you have to take care in the case of learning. So, this learning can be supervised learning. That is, training data includes desired outputs. That is, learning is supervised here. That is, supervised means we are under a particular supervision. I am saying that, one moment. So supervised learning means this training data includes desired outputs. We say, if this is the case, if the tumor is up to this size, then we say a particular one, this is a learning is supervised. We will be saying this is a benign tumor, this is a malignant one. Like that, we will be deciding on the output. So that is the thing that will be taking care in the case of supervised learning. Unsupervised learning, training data does not include the desired outputs. We don't have the desired outputs here. With the training itself, we don't have the desired outputs. Now, this is like a clustering. Now, we know so many clustering methods. Now, all these neighborhood things will be clustered together. And it will be, that will be very hard to say that it is a good learning over there. So that is an unsupervised learning. Now, there is another one thing that is called as the semi-supervised learning. Now, here you will be having a few of the desired outputs. In supervised learning, you have only desired outputs. In unsupervised learning, you don't have any desired outputs at all. Now, here in the case of semi-supervised learning, you have a few desired outputs. That is, we don't give complete desired outputs. You give some unknown things also and the known things also. Supervised learning. Then another one which is most commonly used is the reinforced learning. Rewards from a sequence of actions. That is, AI types like it. So it is the most ambitious type of learning that we will be using. So these are the four or five types of, that is four types of learning that we will be using. Now in this, now we are going to see about the inductive learning. So learning is an important term in the case of machine learning. So now we are going to see about the inductive learning. So from the perspective of inductive learning, we have a input x, we have the output samples f of x, and from that we are trying to determine the function f. Are you able to follow now? Am I clear, or am I fast, or something like that? Is it clear what I am telling?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, you're having an sample, input sample x. Now output samples f of x is there. From that, we are going to estimate the function f. So the problem is to generalize from the samples and the mapping, you have to find new samples in the future. So when new unknown sample comes, you have to map it with the desired future. With desired output, you have to map it. So it is very hard to estimate when the function is, that is good approximations. If it is not found there, then it will be very difficult. So in the, this is like example of inductive learning, let me say. X is the properties of a credit risk assessment. So X is the properties of the customer. So customer X has some properties, like how he repays the thing and everything like that. Now F of X is credit is approved or not. Now depending upon these properties, so if this property is there, this property is there, and this is not there, you can sanction. Like that, you will be having the assessment. So depending upon those rules and hypotheses are, that is being programmed. That function F is determined by the machine learning function. Same way in the case of disease diagnosis. So X are the properties of the patient. Now F of X is the disease they suffer from, whatever may be the disease. Now we have to find a function F that maps this properties of X correctly with whether they have a tumor or not a tumor. Our function has to be very approximate, because we should not have any false positive or true negative. You should not say someone having a disease that you are not having a disease, or someone with no disease you should say you are having a disease. Both are extreme end. So that you have to take care in the case of disease diagnosis. Next, face recognition. X, you have a bitmap of faces. You have an image of faces. Now from there, you have to assign a name to the face. So you have to give a name to the face, so that name will be taken care, that particular one F determines which name it assigns. So depending upon some mapping of the properties, we take a 75% map with this particular character. So this we will be mapping with this, this is that particular person, like that we determine. Then automatic steering. So we have so many bitmaps of the camera in front of the car. Our car has so many bitmaps. Whether there is any obstacles, whether there is a car hazard, whether there is any turn, or whatever it is. Then F of X is the degree of steering the wheel, it should be turned. If there is a right turn, left turn, or go straight, whether we have to stop, slow down because there is a car in front. All those things has to be determined by the decisions and the rules and the artificial intelligence that has to be implemented in the function F, so that we have the auto steering of this. So these are some examples of inductive learning. So when you should use this inductive learning? That is, first one is problems when there is no human expert. That is, if people do not know the answer, they cannot write a program to solve it. So these are the areas of true discovery. If you know human expert is the needed, they cannot write a program. In that case, we can use this particular inductive learning. Now, in another one, humans can perform the task, but no one can describe how to do it. They know to do the task, but they don't know how to do it. So in that case, like riding a bike or driving a car, human know it, but they cannot describe how to do it. We cannot describe to the computer how to do it. So that things that can be done. So sometimes the desired function changes frequently. That is, humans could describe it, they could write a program to do it, but the problem changes too often. Each time it changes, it's not cost effective. That is the stock market. Anything we say now, it may not be say after some 24 hours to be true. So in that case, what is the things to be done? So that function you have to be determined. At that time, you can use the inductive learning. And then problems where each user needs a custom function. That is, every user need a different program. That is, like you shop at a site like Amazon or Netflix, or where you watch movies, Amazon or something. You, depending upon your favorite movies, you are selecting whether it is comedy or whatever type of films that you are watching. Depending upon that, the film list will be popping up. These are some favorite of yours. This can be the thing you can require to watch on. So this changes from customer to customer. So depending upon what I have previously watched, with that the decisions is being taken. So that is the problems where each user needs a custom function. Every user it will be changing, the type of movies or whatever it is. Even shopping, when we do what we have shopped before. So those things pop out. That changes from customer to customer. Those things we can use the inductive learning. Then the essence of inductive learning is, now we cannot have a perfect function for inductive learning. That is, we cannot be overfit. That is, if a curve, if it is over, something like in, even in electronics, you cannot have an ideal signal like that. You cannot have a perfect fit for an inductive learning. So that is one, we cannot have a, that is, this data perfectly matches. It will correctly 100% you will achieve this. There is nothing like that. You can achieve to some extent, that is 99.9. Okay, you can say, but it is not 100% achievable. Maybe for some data, it may be failing. So that is the thing. So the main challenge what we have here is, we have to select the specific model. Now, when we see the hands-on section, we will see how there is a bad fit. Now, when it is a bad fit, we should not use the model. So like that, we will be seeing the thing. So we have to have a good approximation of the function to have a very good learning. Now, there are two perspectives on this inductive learning. That is, you have to remove the uncertainty. That is, having data remove some uncertainty. Depending upon the hypothesis, even if the output is uncertain for that, the function F has to remove the uncertainty for us and give a solution for that one. So that is one perspective. Then learning is guessing a good and a small hypothesis there. Sometimes I can guess, maybe this is the output. I can have a small guess and I will apply a small hypothesis class. Both the things, but there will be a trial and error process. I'll be giving a trial and error process and I'll be checking out this and this. Now I could be wrong sometimes. Now maybe I should need some prior knowledge. So if I need a prior knowledge, I will train my data set. I will train my data set in that, and then I will go for the testing. So we start with a small hypothesis class. Usually we will be starting with a small class of things, then we slowly grow our hypothesis. So to have a good result. So this is how you have to proceed when you have a problem. And for that problem, how you solve it, you have to proceed it in with a small class. That is, if you have so many features there, include these two features, like this, like you can include like that and you can find out. Now, your framework for studying inductive learning is, first, the terminology that and all you should have. You should have a training example. That is a sample X, including its outputs from the target function. You have an X, and for this, I know the output. I should have known. Maybe I'm having 1,000 data, of which 700 data, I know the output. This is the output. That is the training example. Then the target function, X and F of X, I know. I have to find F. That is my target function that I have to find. Now, how do I get this F? For that, what is the hypothesis I have to use? That I have to determine. Then I have to classify it. What is the concept behind classifying? Is that having a tumor, or this is, or it is going to this class, or one or zero, like that? It is a simple classifier or a four classifier. It is going to classify into four types or one type, two types, or like that. You have to determine depending upon what classifier you are going to have. Then the learner, which process, the learning method or learning model, which will be using as the classifier, that will be seen. Then the hypothesis space, there this possible approximations takes place. How this F function is taking place, how we are going to take approximation from that, all those things will be taken. Then version space is something, a subset of the hypothesis space. You can have feature set, subsets of the feature set. This set, I can type, we are applying this hypothesis. Is it coming out proper? Or again, I change to another different set. Like that, it may be moving on. So depending upon which gives a better result, you should have a trial and error fashion. Now, what is the key issues in machine learning? If you don't have, what are good hypotheses? You should know what is the good hypothesis. If you don't know a good hypothesis, our machine learning won't work properly. Which algorithm should I take? Any, which model I should use? Which optimization accuracy I should take? And how do we have a confidence in this model? Whether my model is accurate, whether I can use it for a medical model. So all this thing, then my learning problems, are they computationally traceable or is this intraceable? like that, all those things has to be taken care. Now, how can we formulate application problems as machine learning problems? That is, already you may have an input, a program, and an output. How am I going to change this into a machine learning problem? So these are the three concerns for choosing a hypothesis. That is the size of our hypothesis, randomness, and the parameter. That is, if my data is so randomly distributed, or my data is very big, or the number and type of parameters is very big, in that case, I can go for a machine learning model. If my input is small, or like that, I can go for an algorithmic model itself, or an application procedure itself, I can go. But when data is very high, so that only for machine learning models, which will have a very big data set, not using some, I had a 40 sample data, I got 50 sample data. No, you should go for a very higher samples of data, 1,000, like that, for the, of which I had 700 as training, 300 as testing, in which I had my model give this much accuracy. Like that, we have to come. Now, there are three properties by which you should choose an algorithm. What is the algorithm you are going to choose? That is the search procedure. That is the direct computation. That is no search, just calculate whatever is needed. That is, we are going to directly compute it. Or local, we are going to have a search through the hypothesis space to refine our hypothesis. We are going to change our hypothesis depending upon our functions. Or constructive, piece by piece, little by little, am I going to build my hypothesis? Little by little, my function, am I going to construct, or like that, it is going to go. So these are the things you're going to use in the search procedure. Timing, eager, learning performed upfront. That is, most algorithms are eager. We try to calculate how much time it takes. Some things are lazy learning. Usually it takes a lazy learning. How a customer views the films, or how he is coming for a shopping at a online shopping thing. These things will be some lazy learning techniques. Then online versus batch. Online learning here, it will be based on each pattern as it is observed. So you what every pattern when I'm giving, the it will be observing what is the hypothesis and how I am getting the output. Batch, I have a group of patterns, I give the pattern, and I see what is the output of my hypothesis. And then another group of patterns like that, I can have one by one my parameter being changed, or I can give my learning to a patterns can be given as a group also, batch also. So this is as it is a hands-on session. So just I have given a few insights to my learning session. That is, just I planned out for just a 20 minutes of PPT presentation. Just I have said what is machine learning, then how the applications of machine learning is, and what are the key elements of machine learning. And we saw what were the types of learning, like supervised, unsupervised, like that, and reinforced, like that, and all semi-supervised. Then machine learning in practice, what, how it is being done. And inductive learning, we have seen it in a little bit in detail, when we should use it, what is the essence of it, and what is the framework for studying the inductive learning. So this is a basic I have given here in the case of machine learning. Now we'll be going to the hands-on session. Okay. One moment. So now in the hands-on session, because I don't know if everybody is having the Python compiler or editor or not. So either you can use a Spider, Anaconda Spider, or Jupyter, or even if you are in online mode, you can go for a GDB online with the Python compiler. Even that is fine for you. Okay. Now, I won't be telling you to type as I type. We need not go slowly. As we are all learned professors, I would just explain the code as such as I am implementing. And for that code, I will put the code in the chat box, and from that you can take it. One moment. So one moment, let me share my entire screen, because I'm having Spider. Even you can choose an online compiler also, online GDB compiler, Python. I shall put it in the chat box. So if you are over the internet, you would be over the internet, you can open it in one of your computer window, online GDB compiler. So it's not a big deal. That is, you should know Python programming. Now, I remember when I was working in as a programmer, one time my boss used to tell me that there was a bug in the Visual Basic programming. So I told him, I don't know Visual Basic. I know only C++, like that. So he said, do you know English? Yes, I know English. Then go and debug the program. So the only thing we know to do programming is just logic and English. You can now just apply the syntax. So don't worry, Python is not a very big thing. It's very easy to learn. So it has such inbuilt data structures. So even if it is for your research works and everything, this Python will be very much helpful. And there are n number of works available on the net also for you to go through and get over it. So we will have a start walkthrough of Python, how it is used in machine learning today. So hope, shall I go to my screen? So online Python compiler you take. So you will be, it will be taking you to the browser window. So one moment, I come to my Meet window. So instead of using Spider, I am trying to come to your this GDB online compiler itself. So it will be useful for every one of you. Okay, Chrome tab. So are you able to see me? Yes.
No, ma'am. Now it is okay.
Now it's okay. So I think you would have opened a screen like this, okay? So now, first we are going to work with some arrays here, okay? So I'm going to work with some arrays for you. One moment, let me. So Python, it works fantastic with the arrays. So hope you are having the GDB window. As I execute, you can look through the window also. My screen, one moment. Let me fit on. Okay. Are you able to? I lost the connection. One minute. Okay. Was I clear when I told her? Was I there on the thing or I lost the connection?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. Now it is clear, ma'am.
Okay. So now here, I'm having an array. Now, as an array, I can give completely in a square boxes with the separated thing. So if you're having some feature vector, you can just give it just like this. And just when you are saying run, this gets into. This is an online compiler I'm having. So it will just print the array. So this is a simple basics. So you will know about the complete thing when you are dealing with the each of the programs. So first we are going to see about a package that is called as NumPy. Okay. So this package, so many things are included in packages inside the Python package itself. Python itself, open source, it is available. So we can use these packages to do so many numerical operations. So of this, this is a numerical Python. Now this says NumPy says this is a numerical Python. I have given import NumPy. So now I'm going to say import NumPy inside my program. So it will import my NumPy. Now I have not used anything of this. So now I'm going to give an array called a speed array, and this is a speed array that I'll be giving. So now instead of this, yes, I'm going to give my speed of my car is 99, 86, 87. This is the different speed at different instances of time I have run. So I'm just printing them. Print, yes, I'm saying print speed. So, are you able to see my window?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible only, ma'am.
Okay. So, that is just I am printing. Now, what do I do with this NumPy? Now, so many times you will be having mean, median, mode, entropy, like that. So many things we will be using arrays, you have to process this. Now, in traditional programming, you have to go each array, you have to go. In MATLAB, two-dimensional arrays, you have to process mean of, the mean two, and the madri podu. Like that, we'll be using. So here, now in this case, let me see how I'm going to give a particular. So I'm going to give a program now for you. Now this is going to, that is the speed. I'm going to have, this is my NumPy. NumPy dot mean, I say. NumPy is the package. In that, I have a function called as mean. I say mean of speed and I print x. So this is the different instances of speed that I have taken. And then for this different instances of speed, what do I have? This is the average speed that I will be having. The 89 is the average speed that I will be having. So each code I will be posting in the chat box. If you want, you can run or you can watch my demo. Afterwards, you can take it from the thing. Okay. Are you able to follow? So this is just I am reading a NumPy array and I am giving. So now, same way, I am going to calculate the median. This is mean. So same way, if you want to calculate the median, I can now say, this is, I want the mean also and the median also. So instead of x, I'll have x1 and x2. X1 calculates the mean. That is the NumPy package calculates the mean of the speed. And this is a median. Median, you know, that is the middle element. So now I run. And this is from my Word, the codes you have to be careful. Sometimes the codes in our Word document, I'm having the program in the Word document for copying easily. So mean is 89.76, what you have seen earlier, and the median is 87. So 87, that is 3, 6, 7th element. You have, that is the, if you arrange it in ascending order and then you take care of it, that will be the thing, that is the median. So this is the second one. So now using NPy array, That is the NumPy array. You have seen how you have calculated a mean and a median. Now, same way, there is another one. What is the mode? What is the mode? Yes. Now, in order to calculate mode, I'll say, so you are going to now use another package called as SkyPy. Now, this is scientific Python. That is a calculator and all you have seen, no? That you have a normal calculator and a scientific calculator. Same way here also, we have something called as a scientific Python. You can use this also for the arrays. From that, I have imported stats alone. That package alone I have imported. So I have the same speed, stats.mode of speed. Mode means how many times, which is having a maximum repetition. So when I run this, I didn't print text. Hope Python is not difficult for you. That is, it has 86 occurs three times, 1, 2, and 3. So what it is returning? It is returning, that is the element 86, it returns, that is, it is occurring three times. Now let me change one more thing as 86 and we will see. So 86 occurs four times. So this is how it calculates the mode of the thing. More frequently, that is good. The next one, this is a simple arithmetic. The next one is, we are going to see the standard deviation. So these are some parameters that you may be requiring in the case of doing your algorithms. So I will say import numpy. I can use this or the stat function. So standard deviation std, so I am printing, so it is giving 0.90. so you can have a standard deviation for your array. Hope I'm not fast. Next, we are going to see variance. What is variance? These are some important parameters which we'll be using. Variance. Variance is the average number of squared differences. Correct? Variance is the average number of squared differences that we will be using. So here you're calculating the variance. So these are some functionalities that we are using here in the case of Python, using Python here. So these are simple functions. Now I'm going to give a very big array here. Now, okay. This is my function over here. I'll give you this array also. Now tell me, I want you to tell how many people are 75%, that is 75% of the people are above which age? That is, I want to know, there are several, this is some ages of the people. I want to know 75% of people are percentile, that is 75% of people are above which age, I want to know. So how will you calculate? So this percentile is a very common thing these days, because when you see the competitive exams and all, there they put the percentile. So NEET exams, JEE, so all these exams, when you see, they will be putting percentile. In which percentile you are? That is, if 13 lakh people has written this particular paper, and your mark stands where, at which percentile, like that. So for that, our Python has a very simple solution. That is, you can just say numpy.percentile ages, that is 75% how above which age they are. I didn't say import and numpy, so that don't forget. Import numpy. So numpy dot, so now it is saying 43 is the age. So 75% of the people are below 45 years. So that is the 75 percentile. So percentile also, you will be having, it will be just how we are going to calculate for a particular one. If 90% of the, what is the age of 90% of people younger than? How you will put it, just what is the age that 90% of the people are younger than or particular one, or particular or one particular age? So same age, same age example only. Ages comma, I'm going to say 90, 61. So 61 is the answer. Okay, so now the little working with the arrays, how to calculate mean, median, standard deviation, variance, mode, these are all very basic parameters that we have now seen. Now we are going to enter into the next step of that. After this, okay, I'm going to enter into the data distribution. Am I clear with this one? If you have a demo like this, is it fine? Yes? Lakshmi sir?
Yes, ma'am. It is okay.
Like this demo, is it okay, sir?
It is very clear, ma'am. Okay.
So now we are going to enter into the next part of the thing, that is data distribution. So first we are going to see a typical normal data distribution. Okay, we are going to see a typical normal data distribution. So I'll put, this is a normal distribution. So I'm going to show you a part of the code. Now look at this code. Now this is a typical normal distribution. I have put a hash to indicate that this is a comment line. Now I have imported a numpy array, and then this is matplotlib. So this is a plot library. You're going to plot the mathematical function. So for that, we are going to use a pyplot. And this one, each time import matplotlib.pyplot means, each time I have to use this big function dot something like that. So instead of that, I'm saying that I can use it as plt. So instead of using this big variable matplotlib.pyplot, I will say plt. Any name you can keep, x, y, z. So plt is something reasonable, so we have kept it like that. So that is the second import function. So here we have seen about the numpy data, we have seen about the scientific Python, that is scipy, and now we have seen about the matplotlib with pyplot. So now we are going to have a normal distribution. See, the numpy has a normal distribution. We can say random dot normal. You are going to give the parameters phi, 1 and some value. So this, let me say, you know what is a histogram? Histogram is of the frequency. of the divisions, how it occurs. So now for the graphical functions, I have to go to the my spider one. So I'll exit from this. I'm going to my presentation of my entire screen. So this is my spider editor, Anaconda Python. So I have created a new one here. So now here I will just give in the command line. This is the console where you can give the command line. This is the editor where you can save a program and run the program. So now this is a normal distribution program. So I am just putting this program, import numpy, and I'm saying I'll execute this program. So can you see a normal distribution? Are you able to see a normal distribution? So this is how we can have. Now the bell shape you want to expand depending upon that, the variables here, that is the input to the normal function, you can change. So as you change, that will get changed. So that is a normal distribution. Now next, there is another thing you most commonly used is the scatter plot diagram. That is you'll be having a scatter plot diagram. How we are going to plot a x comma y function here? One moment. Okay, I'm just putting the thing for your explanation. Next, I'm having a scatter plot. Okay, so here to clear the screen, I can just say CLR. It will clear my clear CLEAR. Okay, clear. So it just clears the screen. I give my next command. Now look at this code. Is the code visible or I have to still increase the font size? Font size, have I to increase, ma?
Ma'am, if possible, kindly increase the font size.
I'm just checking. Because I think it will be too small for you to see like that, editor. One moment, just a minute.
Okay, ma'am.
Otherwise, we can continue with the same.
Yes, found out. Okay. Okay. I'll come to my presentation. Okay. Hope it is little bit clearer now.
Yes, ma'am, it is very clear, ma'am.
Okay. So now here I am having two x and y arrays. Okay. Now I want to plot it as a scatter plot. That is, I want to plot all these points in an array at one stretch. Okay. So I have plot. That is, this is you are using a matplot, this library function. As plt, so I say plt dot scatter of x comma y, and I'm saying show. So now what happens? Now if you see the chart, now it just plotted this particular function. So it will just plot it over here. So this code and everything, if you want afterwards, I will give you. So each time, I think the demo is okay. I think so. Afterwards you can get the code for you to work on it, I think so. What do you feel? Or are you working on it? Lakshmi sir?
Ma'am, we can share the code later, ma'am.
Share the code later. Okay, sir. So this is how the scatter plot works over here. So the next one is linear regression. Okay. So now linear regression means, now here in this, I want to pass a line. That is usually the classifier, like a support vector machine and here and all. Now, when you want to classify the data, now there will be, you will be having two sets of data. One is a diseased one, one is a not a disease. You will be having, or you will have, this is a particular type of one, another is of another different type. Now, you want to classify using a single line. That is your linear regression. Now, this linear regression line, which separates your scatter plots, that is your points, these points lie with this side is of disease. The points that lie after this line, they are of not disease. Like that, you are going to fix a line over there. Okay. So for that, you have to use a linear regression model. Okay. So I'll use a clear screen. I'll explain each code of you what I am writing. So this one, up to this, the same scatter plot I have taken. That is the same thing. Import matplotlib, that one, scipy, import stats. Now I have imported a function, statistic function also now, because that only has my linear regression model. Okay, so for plotting, I have included the plot, and for putting this linear regression model, I have this. So the next sentence I introduce is slope, intercept, r comma p comma standard error, and what is the error and everything. So many things it is returning, stats dot linear regression. So later we will see what is this particular parameters and all. So stats dot linear regression, for what we are going to form? For this particular plot x and y, you are going to form the linear regression model. So def my function of x returns slope into x plus intercept. So this is just a function. So this is an interpreter. So it will execute first this one, second, third, fourth, fifth, and then it comes to the my model function. Now list of map of, now it keeps it as a list. List, you can have any type of data elements. Now for that list, I am sending the my function as my thing. So I am calling my model, that is called x. So each x it will take, and for each x, it will form a slope into x plus intercept. Okay, so it would have got an intercept here. For each one, this intercept is used here. Slope is got from here. So slope into x plus intercept, it will calculate in this function. So now mx plus c, so that will be a line, straight line. For a straight line, you will be having mx plus c. So you have a model here. Now I first plot my points, and with that points I want to plot. So first I give the scatter plot, then I say plot x comma my model. So this my model will have the line. So when you show that, you will be having, can you see? So this is the linear regression model. So now in this linear regression model, now we have plotted the points. So I don't know whether my model is good or not, whether it is overfit or it is underfit or it is a best fit, that I won't be knowing. But I have created a model now. So for my plot, I have created a model with the linear regression one for this particular data that I have given. Okay. Now, in the same function, now I will print R. What is R now? Now, this is the R is the squared error. That is how well my data fits into the regression. Now, R is how well my data fits into the regression. That is your R value. So from that R value, I can know, okay, 75% it fits into my thing, but 25% there is going to be a failure. So still I have to change my hypothesis such that I can increase the R value. So like that, I have to move on. So same data. Now, since this will be in the memory itself, I have just printed the R as such. Okay. Now I am going to clear. I am going to now a similar program. Now a similar program I have created. That is X and Y I have. This is now a particular X and Y values. This X and Y values give, I want to predict the speed of my 10-year-old car. This is first X gives me my 5-year-old car gives 99, 7-year-old gives 86, like that. The speed of my car I have predicted. Now, instead of printing that particular one, now I'm saying instead of plotting and printing, I want to predict. Prediction is a very important one in the machine learning. So now I'm going to predict. How I'm going to predict? My function of 10. So it says 10 is not at all in X. In X, we do not have a value called 10-year-old. It is having 5, 7, 8, 2, 17, 9, so many things are there. But 10 is not there. Now I am able to predict for 10-year-old, my speed of the car will be some 85.59. Now same way, I can say speed equal to my function will be already there. My function of, shall I say 30? Funk spelling. Print of speed. Can you see? So if it is a 13-year-old car, my speed will be how much? Only 80. Okay, so this is how the prediction from a linear regression model. So this is the simplest model. So this linear regression model, we have just plotted it. We have sent it into a model and we are trying to predict what is the speed of the car or whether we can do this. Like that, we are predicting it with a linear regression model. Okay. Now I'm going to give you a bad fit now. Same linear regression model only. I'm just printing this. This is the my model. That is, the function is same. My data is different. Okay. So when you are processing different kinds of data, as researchers, when you will be doing different kinds of data, every model, a model that fits to your core researcher will not fit into your mind. It depends on the data that you are using. So when see the same code I'm using now here, now X and Y are having different data now. Now X and Y are having a different data over here. Now in this different data, now I am plotting, I am having a, now last time I printed my R, that was 75. Now print my R, look at my R. What is my R? It is 1%. Now for this kind of data, I can never use a linear regression model. I can never use it because it is a very, very bad best fit, I can say. This is a best fit model for this particular data. But for my speed of the car, that particular data, that model was okay. But for this, that was 75% okay. So I can, that is not going to make a very big difference. But here, it is giving only a 0.01. This is very low R value. So this model won't get fitted over there. So the data determines which model we have to fit in. So the data and our output, what we want. So that we'll be seeing step by step. Hope I'm clear. So same thing, I directly printed out. So the next we will see. Now this is a straight line. Now what we are having here is a straight line. Now instead of a straight line, now sometimes we would have to fit in a curved line. So that comes over polynomial regression. So instead of linear straight lines. So instead of that, we'll be going for a polynomial regression. So now I'm going to have a polynomial fit. I think I'm going to show a same xy data. My look at my data, it looks like a curved function over here. So for this curved function, now I cannot use a linear regression model. So the scatter plot itself shows it is being distributed in a different fashion. So I cannot use a linear regression model here. So I go in for a what type of model? A polynomial regression model. Polynomial regression model. So same thing. Now instead of linear regression, now from NumPy, I am using poly one dimensional. If it is two dimensional, we will be using two dimensional. So now initially we are seeing poly one dimensional, and then we have to say line space 1, 2, 100. That means I am stating that it starts at 1 and ends at 22. It moves on like that. This gives the model fitting. That is X and Y. It is fitting at a rate of 3, it is saying. So now look at the line that it draws. Now can you see how the linear regression, instead of putting a straight line, now for our data, it has fitted in a curved line. So that is the curved line that has been fitted. Now, if you see here, the polynomial model and the line space, you have to start at position and end at position 22, I am saying. So, it has a maximum. Yes.
Ma'am, a few of our participants are working simultaneously. They are asking for the codes. Kindly post the codes in the chat.
Okay. Now, I'll start from this one. Okay. Okay. Now as I go now, last I will give you the Word document. You can take the code, so that won't be a big problem. Now as and when I put the thing on the thing on the chat box. Okay. After this follow. So look at how easy Python has made it. So that is the power of Python. Now, as you go deep and deep and deep into it, in some few lines of code, every model you can run. Every model at one stretch you can run and find out which model fits fine for your data. That is how it will be. Okay. So this is good. So now here we are fitted in a polynomial model. Okay. Now we are going to see R squared. That is how well the relationship that is between the values x and y axis, how it is just fitting in, how well my data. Now there in linear regression, we saw how well our data fitted into the polynomial regression, how it fitted, how was it good or bad or something like that. So same way, now I am also going to see how my model fits into it. So for that, I have a value over here. Clear my screen. Okay. I have a, that is same thing, my model. Okay. So now here, print R2 score. Now this gives the score of Y with my model of X. This is very important. Okay, that is for my Y. Okay, now I am going to give some new X, and for that X, it will return the y value, correct? That is our function. So like that, we are going to give, that is your training with some x values, and for each of the x values, I have a different y values. Now, after which, I will be giving some unknown x values for which y values has to be predicted. Okay, now I want to know whether the polynomial that I have fitted now is a very good one or not. For that, I have the R2 score. I say y comma my model of x. So my model of x, it gives me 94. So 94% it was okay. Now when we look at into that graph itself, take the previous code. When you look at the graph itself, you can see how best it has fitted, correct? So 94% it has been fitted into it. So that is a very good score for us. So for this particular data, everything again and again, I'm underlining that is the data. Depending upon the data, you have to choose a hypothesis, you have to choose a model, you have to choose a how well it fits into your solution, okay? So that is the R square value. Now next, predicting future values. So now for this my model polyfit, I am going to check. One moment. That is, now for this from sklearn, okay, we are using dot matrix. Now we have come to your fourth package, I think so. NumPy, SciPy, Matplotlib, and then now sklearn. So this is another one learning matrix. So this has an R2 score. From this only we are importing the R2 score. So now, can you see our previous one for each of the one? Now 88 is the my model of 17. What it is? It will be 88. Okay, so for this polynomial model, I have fitted the one. Now let us see a bad fit for the polynomial model. Wait, I didn't post this code. So this is a prediction in a polynomial model. Now we are going to see a bad fit. See, look at this. Now same like our bad fit there, here also the bad fit is very Now you yourself try to find out the R2 score here and post it on the thing if you have. Those who have, what will be the R2 score? Can you see the R2 score? 0.009. Okay, so it is a very bad fit. Okay, so for this one, this polynomial, it is not able to fit it into it. So for this data, we cannot use this model. So for a linear regression also, I showed a very good fit and a bad fit. For a polynomial regression also, now you have seen a very bad fit and a good fit also. Okay. Now we are going to use another I'm going to import. I don't know how to send the file. Now we are going to work on this. This is single dimensional data. Till now we have worked. Now we are going to move into the two dimensional data. I don't know how I'll share with you. One moment. Give me one second. So the next one is, we are going to see about a car data, okay? How much weight, how much carbon dioxide it emits, like that and all, we are going to see. So car file. Okay, I am going to have a car file now. So I'll present my screen again. I'll present my entire screen. Okay. Now we are going to have another one, clear? We are going to use import pandas, and then I don't know where my pandas file is there. Now I shall put it in the editor now, okay? Okay, I'll have downloaded the file. So cars.cv, CSV, that is just an Excel file. Okay, I will just open the file and show you. We are having some data over there. Now we are going to work with this two-dimensional data. Okay. This data I have sent to Lakshmi sir. Lakshmi sir can see how it can be distributed. Okay, now this is a car. Now this is the model of the car. Toyota, something Mitsubishi, like that, Audi. So many cars are there. Now this is the model number, model, and what is the volume, what is the weight, what is the carbon dioxide emission. I have five columns. So now this becomes a two-dimensional data. Okay, now instead of having one row, now we have started to use now two rows. So this is the data that we are going to use now. So let us come to the thing. Now let me see, it has imported. So okay, we have imported the data. Now even on the net, you can just search for this cars.csv, you will be getting the file for a download. Okay, got the file from the net only. So now next, we are going to take okay, we want to know how much is the carbon dioxide emission depending upon the parameters. Okay, so now I'm going to, x are the parameters I'm going to determine, and y is my output, y is my predicting function. So now I have taken weight and volume as my x, and y is equal to carbon dioxide. Are you able to understand? Weight, there were five columns, one was carbon dioxide, and there one was weight cylinders. Now I have taken weight and volume as my x variable, and y is my carbon dioxide. Okay, so I'm going to find out the y only. So now from sklearn linear model, I'm going to use a linear model. I shall take the whole example as such, and okay, I'll explain. See here, now x I have taken the weight and volume, and this is the carbon dioxide. Now this is our linear model, okay, linear regression. Now look, before we have seen from another package, we use the linear regression. Now we have another package, that is sklearn. From that I'm using the linear model, linear regression. Okay, so now for this I say fit. We have to fit our model with what values? I have x, weight and volume, and y is my carbon dioxide. So I say capital X and small y. It is case sensitive, so capital X and small y. Now predicted CO2 will be, now this is the output of the linear model. So that regression dot fit we have given from the model, I have tried to fit the thing, and there I'm predicting 2300 we are giving. So weight is 2300 kg, and the volume is 1300 cm³. Weight and volume now I'm giving. For that I'm trying to find out the 107 as the predicted CO2. This you can change and see. Is it clear now? You are going one step ahead with two-dimensional data. Now, two-dimensional data, usually in your research, you will be working only with two-dimensional data, because your parameters or feature set or whatever you are getting, you will be having it in many columns, correct? So those columns, now, and one will be the predicted value. One is going to be predicted. Either you will have y as the predicted. That is one column. Why you won't have many values? Remember, y is going to be carbon dioxide means carbon dioxide. Even I can have weight and carbon dioxide on x, and y may be the volume. I'll try to find out if carbon dioxide is this much and weight is this much, what is my volume? I can, because my model is trained. So even that you can check and see. So let us consider. But I have trained the model with weight and volume. So that means I have to train with weight and carbon dioxide, and you have to take volume over here. Okay, so if you want, you can try and see. Have I pasted this? Yeah. Okay, so same thing now you take over here. Now here when it is in the command window, it will be difficult for you to process. So now here I'm going to have, instead of volume, I'll put carbon dioxide, and this I'm going to say volume. Okay, now this I will say, let me say 107. Let me see what it is going to give. What was my volume? It is giving a volume of 2670. Weight and carbon dioxide, and is trying to calculate the volume. I'm giving a carbon dioxide of 107 over here. So like this, any parameter you can change. Now, researchers' work includes in which parameter you are going to include. That, even for that, there are some best fit methods and all in how we are going to take which parameter to leave out, and for that and all in Python, you have very good models. That is where you can leave out. This is this parameter doesn't give much importance for our output prediction. You can leave out that parameter like that and all. There is some things. So little by little we'll be seeing. So this is how we will be predicting the output. Now same program, a little different way. Now look at my cars.csv, weight and volume, carbon dioxide, linear regression, fit. I want to know how good is my thing. So look, this is my regression coefficient. Okay, so it will, this regression coefficient, it shows to the unknown variable. So this is what we will be having. That is, weight is having a, this is for the weight regression coefficient, and this is the regression coefficient of the volume. Okay, that is, both weight and volume are present over here. Okay, this regression coefficient, it should be lower enough for having a better prediction. So here it is lower, so it is giving a better prediction, we can say that model. So each time you have to check how much is the coefficient. So then only you can have whether we can go for this model or not. Are you able to understand the two-dimensional data? Now look here, I have given print of DF. DF is the CSV file I have read. Okay. So this will give me the complete file contents, model, volume, and everything. Okay. Now if I say print of df.head, sorry, df.head of five, I think so. It will give the first five lines. Okay, that is print df.head dot okay. Same way I can say, if you put the up arrow, it will give the previous line. Tail, last five lines. Okay, print df of tail of, okay. Now the same code which you have seen earlier, weight and volume, just change the values, 3300 and you had 114. So same thing you can run and see, 114 you will be getting. Now an important thing in understanding the result is, that is, if you are having a result like this, that is predicted CO2 is you are predicting for this weight and volume, you should be understanding for this weight, this volume, this predicted output, others are all going to be different. So whatever we are giving, so that you should be able to say your you should be able to interpret your results how it is being there. Okay. Next, whenever we are doing research, there will be one important problem that will be coming across. The values will be different. That is, the range of values between each of them will be different. Now, look at this. Here it is, volume 1000 to 1000 like that. Here it is in some carbon dioxide in 99. So, if you want to scale the values, so we are going to scale the values. So normalization, Madhuri. So it's like something called as normalization. We are going to normalize the values. So you'll be reading the file. Look here. That is, you have weight and volume. You are going to scale it. Scale dot fit transform of x. Now, if you want more columns, you will just add comma separated, and you will be putting a within the quotes the header of the row. Okay, and fit transform, it will just fit it into so that you can plot it easily. Plotting will be easier for any scatter matrix or whatever it is. It will be an easier thing. So this is your scaling function. Let me give it to you. Now we are going to predict the CO2 values using the scaled vectors. That is, now if you scale, after scaling, the result for us should not vary, correct? So pandas, you have x and y. We are trying to fit the transform now. After fitting the transform, then we are sending the transform into the scaled x. We are sending it into the linear regression. Fit scaled x. Before, how, what we are given? Before, we are given x, capital X. Without scaling, we had given. Now we would have given with the scaling. So now, one moment. I didn't use the pandas library. Okay. I gave cars.2. It was cars. Okay. So cars.5. So it is 97. So predicted CO2, it will be different this one. Because after the scaling, it will be giving a better value. So scaling is one important function that you have to do in the case of processing your data. Now is the important part, this train and test. Now always training and testing data. That is, Python is so wonderful that it itself will split the train and test data. So you are having thousands of data. Let us have 1,000 data, and you want to split some 700 data as a train set and 300 as a test set. You can choose, like, first 700 is train, next 300 is test. Okay, so you can choose like that one way. Or you can randomly, you want to choose some 700 data as random train and then the other 300 as test. So that also Python will allow you. So the training and testing data is very important. So as we have seen in the PPT, that samples that we are selecting, that is to be very important. So now we are going to see about the train and the test. That is, usually it is 80% of training and 20% of testing, or depending upon how you feel, 70% of training and 30% of testing. So let us now take a data. Am I clear? Okay. This is a data. Now I have created a data with the NumPy random seed 2. I have created a data. And with that, I have formed a normal distribution. And that normal distribution, y data, I have taken normal another distribution divided by x, and I have distributed them into the scatter matrix. So this is some random data that is being distributed. Okay. Now in this data, I want to split and train the data. Sariya, have I pasted this? This is very important. So in this, now the test and the train data, how I'm going to take is x, train y, test y I need. x:80. So from the beginning till 80. Okay. So from the beginning till 80, and when we say 80, Python takes from 0 to 79. Okay, when I say 80 here, it is 80 minus 1. So Python takes 0 to 79. Okay, now here 80 to end. So from 81 to how much ever data is there, you can take it over there. Okay, so I'm taking it like that. So that is my train, that is my test. Now we are going to see what is the train data. How is our train data? See, this is our train data. Something little datas are removed from there, some 20% of the data. So this is our train data. And I want to show you the test data. So this is the test data I have taken. So I have taken this, distributed this data, 80 as train and 20 as test. So this is the so you are having a normal data, train, test. Over one polynomial regression, we are placing the line space. It starts at 0, ends at 6. Then the train X and train I, and I am training my model. So it has drawn a polynomial function. Okay, plot dot show. So this is the polynomial function that I have generated now. Now this polynomial data, now I want to find out the R2 score of this. So I can give R2 score is equal to train Y, my model of train X. My model is what? It is being returned here from polynomial one dimension. And train S and train Y I have given. I want to know the R2 score. So print of R2. So 79% it is fitting in. Okay. So you find out the R2 score and print of R2 over there. So you'll be getting a data. Now this data, now our model has been trained now. Now I have to see how is my test going to take place. Okay. Now we have to find when testing the data, how it is. So print my model of 5. So it is giving 22. So my model of 5 means now 5 where it will fall. So at the 5 there will be an intersection, so it will cut the polynomial line over here. Instead of the scattered things, it will cut the polynomial over here, and that is giving a value of 22. Let us see what is the value of polynomial of 2. 65 something. Can you see it is little above? So it is giving 65. If you say print polynomial model of 6, it is 189. It is going up. 6, it is up 189. So it will try to fit it into the curve which you are having. Okay. So I think we have seen a training, testing, linear model, regression model, then polynomial regression. So any queries you have? Lakshmi sir?
No ma'am, it's clear ma'am. Okay.
One moment. Now that there is another file to be for decision tree to be taken into. You need another one more file, so I'll leave that one. So we'll have a quick scan through of what you have seen. So we have seen you may have different types of data. So depending upon the data you have to choose a model. And whenever you choose a model, you have to see the R2-score, whether it is correctly fitting your model. And depending upon that, the prediction has to be okay for your particular model. That you have to check with the R2-score. So, and then training and testing of the data. Now, with this preliminary things that we have seen, you will be able to understand how to train and test a particular one. This is the basics I have given. Now, this is like a building step stone I have given. From this, you can see further codes on the net and you can build your own system on machine learning. So, thank you so much. And if you have any queries, feel free to ask me.
Ma'am, we received some questions from audience, ma'am. Does
okay,
scaling ma'am. Improve the model?
Tell me, ma'am.
Ma'am, one question from the audience, ma'am. Does scaling improve the model?
Scaling improves the model. It will improve the model because when you have different sizes of data set, when you are sending it into the neural network or whatever, even when you are using a neural network or any artificial learning, scaling has to be done because one data may be between 0 to 1. Another data may be from 1,000 to 10,000. So at that time, those data has to be scaled in a similar fashion and that will improve the model.
And one more question, will it affect the accuracy of the model? The scaling
will not affect the accuracy of the model. The data is being plotted into a different scale, that's it. The data distribution is same only. That is if for let me say for if I am having speed from 0 to 100, now if I am scaling it to 0 to 1, 82 speed will be 8.2. Okay, but when I am plotting it against the volume, how much the car has, that will be in this again 0 to 10 scale, and that will be corresponding to that number only. So scaling will not change the accuracy, but it will help your model to improve your models. That is for you to understand. That is the particular data when it is having different, we are plotting in a particular scale or seeing the data in a plotted matrix, that will be easier when it is in a particular scale. Because if you are going to plot the volume, speed, and everything inside one matrix, let us consider one plot, then one will be from 0 to 1,000. Then that means we cannot see the speed curve at all. So if it is being scaled and we can plot everything together in one map itself, that's just the thing for our understanding only. Even if you don't scale it, it will work, but for you to see how it is being distributed for us to visualize, it will be difficult.
Thank you, ma'am. One more question. Kindly explain reinforcement learning with an example code.
reinforcement learning thing. So maybe if some other sessions we can give, or I'll give you, I'll pass on the code to you. Okay. So that is the most
important. Thank you, ma'am. If you have any queries, kindly.
So many other models. That is a decision tree. But that will improve into a forest like that. Each learning, that is little by little. The reinforcement learning is like you learn a decision tree. That is group of trees together. Now this group of trees together, then all together they'll join into a forest. So random forest classifier may work well like that. So that maybe I can share a sample code with you so that you can try on your own and check it out. So
thank you, ma'am. Participants, any queries?
Thank you everyone for your patient listening, and I hope I have given justification to my machine learning basics. Machine learning is an ocean. You have to dig enough to get the pearls. So just dig enough, more and more. You can have further visit to various websites where machine learning and Python are connected, and they are very well explained, and you will be easy to understand all these concepts. And anytime you can, any doubts, you can always ask me. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your effective handling of the session, ma'am. Really, it is a thank wonderful you. Session. Your simplified teaching and training will create research thoughts on Python programming for machine learning among the participants. Now we shall conclude the session with a vote of thanks by Mr. P. Kannan, Assistant Professor, Department of ECG.
Yes, good evening, all of you. So it is a great honor to propose a vote of thanks on this special occasion. First of all, I thank Lord Almighty for giving this opportunity to contact this AICP-sponsored STTP. At the outset, I thank the resource person, Dr. Caroline Vaila Stella Mary, Professor, IT Department, Francis Xavier Engineering College, for having presented the topic on machine learning using Python as a hands-on session. Ma'am, on behalf of EC department and my own behalf, I thank you very much for your wonderful session, ma'am.
Thank you. Next, thank you.
Next, I thank the management for their guidance and motivations to organize this STTP during this lockdown to make the faculty participants from various institutions enrich their knowledge in the relevant fields. Next, my sincere thanks to Dr. K. Jayakumar, General Manager Development, and Dr. Vivel Murugan, Principal, Francis Engineering College, and Dr. L. R. Priya, Professor Academic, for their endless support to make this STTP a successful one. Further, I take this opportunity to thank Professor J. Friska, Head of the Department, for the valuable advice and direction towards making this STTP a grand success. Thank you, ma'am. Next, I thank the coordinator of this event and all the faculty members of BC Department. Next, finally, my sincere gratitude to all the participants for your active participation. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you.